Welcome to the CLIMAX Academy Live. I'm Jim Miller, the Global Training Manager. And today we're going to be talking about the setup of the ODF30. So we have a short video to watch and also have a machine set up here in case there's any specific questions related to the machine. So I always want to start off with the opportunity, if you have any questions, go ahead during this presentation. If you have any questions, go ahead and go to the bottom of your screen, that Zoom Q&A, and type them in, and we'll get to them right after the video plays. So as always, I like to start off with safety. I always want to do a risk assessment of the area that I'm going to be working in. I want to be, you know, careful and cautious of any hazards that I might find myself running into, any cords, any kind of cabling that might be hanging around, any trip hazards that might be around. You know, anytime I'm going to make any kind of adjustments when operating the machine, I want to make sure that I disconnect from power. I want to always watch out for sharp objects, any kind of cutting tools, any kind of pinch hazards that that I might run into, the travel of the machine. You know, these machines are pretty well contained, so it's not the pinch hazards aren't as prevalent as, say, a milling machine or something like that. Okay, so now that we've talked about that and we're pretty comfortable with our surroundings, we'll go ahead and get this video started. But again, while the video's playing, if you see anything that doesn't make sense, or if you have a thought about something else that in the setup of the machine, go ahead and type those in at the Zoom Q&A at the bottom of the screen, and we'll get to those after. So, okay, enjoy the video. Hi, my name's Jim Miller, and today we're going to be covering the setup of the H&S ODF30 Speed Facer. So we're going to start out with the machine in the box. We're going to rig it onto the flange, do the centering and leveling, and we'll do a little component recognition as well. And then in a future video, we're going to be doing some operational techniques. I hope you enjoy the video, and I hope it's instructional. We'll go through each of the components and how they operate, and hopefully it'll be helpful to you. So when we're ready to lift the machine, I want to make sure that I orient the arm so that it doesn't interfere with the placement of my lifting eyes. And also, I want to make sure that I use the four heavy-duty lifting eyes, and I like to put the chain from the inside, so as I lift, there's no chance of it popping off of the hook. So now I'm ready to lift it into position and preset it for my flange. So we have to place the feet block onto the ring, and we have to have them roughly at the right location. I'm going to be using these four holes to mount the foot onto the ring because I have a limited range of travel of the foot itself. And so I have to have it roughly placed on the ring in the right location, and then I attach it with these four bolts. So at this point, I'm going to go ahead and mount, now that I've got the appropriate hole pattern lined up, I'm going to just go ahead and mount this foot up to the ring, and we'll just repeat that on all four feet. So now that I've got the jaws in the rough position, I want to preset the feet before I set it down on the flange. So I want to go ahead and measure between, and I want these to be about a quarter of an inch bigger than the flange itself. And that way, when I do set it down, I'm setting it right down on the setup fingers rather than having to wrestle with it once I get it down close. So I've preset all four jaws, and I've preset the position of the jaw, and I've preset the adjustment of the jaw, so I'm about a quarter inch over the flange size. So now I'm ready to set it down. Okay, so now that I have this preset, I can just go ahead and bring this down set it right on those setup fingers. And then once I'm to this point, I can go ahead and take the crank and go away, and we'll do our final adjustment from there. Okay, so now that we've set the machine down just roughly onto the workpiece, I have the option to take my lifting eyes off. If they're in your way, like they are going to be in this case where they're interfering with me adjusting the foot, I'll take them off. Or if I'm vertical, or if I'm at a position where they're going to hang up and potentially come in contact with the feed or any other rotating object, I'll take them off. But just so you know that it's an option. And so these are just the provided wrench that comes along with it. These just unthread, and the bolt is actually retained as part of the lifting eye. And so you can just take these off and set them down in the toolbox till you're ready to use them again to lift the machine. Okay, so now that I've removed my lifting eyes, I'm just roughly sitting here on the flange. So what I want to do is I want to take an accurate measurement from the inside of the ring to the OD of the flange. And I want to measure that on both sides. And then I can take my wrench and adjust my jaws to get me right on center. So I'll do the first setting close this way, and I'll do my second set this way. And I just want to get it close to center and snug before I do my leveling process. Now that I'm centered, I've gone ahead and I've adjusted just by scale, and I'm less than a 32nd off center-wise. Plenty close for a raised face or a flange that I'm just going to cut across. If I need to have like an RTJ or a O-ring, then I can actually put a test indicator in and I can dial exactly in to the thousandths. But for this purpose, it's more than close enough. So I snug down the center, and I've got the jaws, you know, plenty tight. And so now I'm going to go ahead and make my level adjustment. Now I check both. I center it, I check level to make sure I'm close, I tighten, and then I do my final adjustment. So this 10 millimeter wrench that's provided is what allows me to adjust the foot up and down. So I'm going to be doing my final adjustment right now. So I indicated on that side I'm at the 80, and on this side I'm at 0, so I want to cut that number in half. So I'm going to bring this right to the 90, and that'll be my number, and then I'll go ahead, and then I'll be ready to go ahead and make a cut. Okay, so now that I've centered and tightened, leveled and tightened, I want to go back and I want to tighten up my jam nuts, make sure that as I operate the machine that it doesn't vibrate itself loose. So I'll go ahead and run those in by hand. The wrench that's provided goes right on. It's a low profile wrench, and then I'll just give it a whack, make sure that it's tight so that it won't back off. Okay, so now we're ready that we've centered and leveled. We're ready to go ahead and take off these setup fingers, and it's just a matter of the bolts are retained, and so I can just back those out and remove them. This allows me to start with my cutter off of the workpiece on the OD or on the ID. So now I can start from either direction. Okay, so the final thing we're gonna do here in our setup video today is go ahead and install the motor. So the motor has the ability to plug in on the top of the machine on the same side as the operation or opposite. And the reason for that is if I ever need to mount this on a tube sheet and I need to mount on the bottom, then I'm basically running the machine upside down. Right, and so in that case, I want to be able to put the motor in from the other end and keep my rotation correct on the exhaust and the input. So for today, we're going to go ahead and put this in. I just got to line the key up. Let's go ahead and slide that in. Locate the set screws here, and we'll go ahead and tighten these down. Right. Plug our air hose in. Red goes to the correct rotation. Go ahead and start our power again. Now we're set up. Okay, thanks for joining us today. Now that we've covered the entire setup of the machine, in a future video, we're gonna be doing the operational side use of the machine. So make sure you stay tuned for that and keep an eye out for the date that we play that video. Thanks for joining. Have a good day. Okay, welcome back. So now it's time for our question and answer time, and it looks like we've got a couple questions here, so I'll let John go ahead and read them off.
What is the minimum clamping on ODF speed facer?
Yeah, okay, so this is a 30, ODF30, and the range, or the number is the range of the machine. So the 30 is a 30-inch machine. Now, with an optional set of extensions, I can reduce that by 10 inches per side. So those extensions allow me to put the jaws in, or the foot, rather than mount them right to the ring, I can mount them into that extension, and that lowers the clamping diameter by 10 inches per side, which is 20 inches overall. So I can actually have a 30-inch machine clamp on an under a 10-inch flange, 9.6 or something like that. So it's kind of a good thing to keep in mind that any of the machines, the ODF 30, 60, 90, 120, you can lower that clamping diameter by 10 inches per side with that extension kit.
Can the ODF machines do an RTJ group?
Okay, great question. Yeah, we're mainly focused on the setup this time, so I didn't really talk too much about tooling and operations, but yes, this machine can do an RTJ groove. An RTJ groove, or sometimes it's called a ring joint groove. It basically is 23 and a half degrees per side and then a flat bottom. So with the proper tooling, a proper grooving tool, you can plunge a straight groove and then kick the head over to the 23 and a half on one side, single point that angle, turn it to the other, and single point that. It has the machine comes with a 360 degree capability of rotating that tool head. And so, yes, it can do chamfers, bevels. I can actually take the feed box and put that on the axial travel like some of our other flange facers, and that allows me to have an axial travel as well as a radial, one or the other at the same time.
Can the ODF machines do back facing?
Yes, so that again is an optional feature or an attachment that you can put on the machine. So basically, a back-facing attachment with an ODF allows you to mount the machine upside down onto a flange, and then you remove the main arm and replace that with the back-facing attachment, which you take the slide and the tool head off of your standard setup, put it onto that back-facing attachment, and now you don't have a beam that crosses over the center line of the machine. And so you can come in from one side. So yes, it does have the ability to do that.
What application would I need back facing for?
Okay, good, yeah, so great. I guess I should have said that in the first question. So if you have a tube sheet, for example, oftentimes the back of the flange is what you're pulling on for clamping, or some kind of a pressure vessel, anything where you have a parallel flange that has to be machined on both sides so that it has a good seal. So, tube sheets, pressure vessels, any kind of a valve really that needs that parallel back face. And it's not necessarily just related to valving or piping. I mean, I often look at things not necessarily industry-based, but operation-based. So, I mean, you could have a fixture out in a shipyard that needs the underside of a flange cut. Well, you know, ODF30 or whatever that diameter, 60, 90, 100, whatever that diameter is, that operation can be done by this machine. So I encourage people, not necessarily industry specific, but application specific, for will that machine fit in there and will it accomplish that goal? So another good question. Okay, looks like, oh, go ahead.
One more?
Yep.
So how long does it take to set up ODF?
Oh, good question, yeah. So the machine will come basically ready to go onto the flange. All like you noticed in the video, all you have to do is set the feet for the range that you're working in. So I mean, an experienced operator who's well trained, and I'll highlight that because I'm the training manager. I want somebody that, if somebody really knows what they're doing, they can have this out of the crate and on a flange within 10-15 minutes. I mean, that's not an issue. Obviously, if you're figuring it out as you go, it can take longer. So it's really hard to say, you know, this is the number. But it's this is a very quick machine to set up. It's very intuitive how to set up. It can go really quick if you know what you're doing. So somebody that's used it before can get this out of the crate and have it on in a really short amount of time. So great question. Okay, so if that's it for today, what I'd like to do is offer you to come in and type those questions, if you have any others, to the askcpmt@cpmt.com. Or if you have any future machines that you'd like to see us do or any topics that you'd like us to cover. Now, stay tuned for another coming video on this same machine where we do the operational. We'll talk about speeds, feeds, cutting tools, all the features that the machine's capable of doing. So thanks for joining, and we'll see you next time.